In 1920, William Butler Yeats wrote a poem called The Second Coming, and the poem was describing his present reality. The War of Independence was going on in Ireland. World War I had just ended, and it's a commentary on what he is seeing as a war-torn world. And he's also, in his words, you can sense that there's anxiety or even fear of what the future will look like. And I want us to watch this video and listen to this poem and let it help with your mindset or frame the way the New Testament talks about the second coming.
The Second Coming by William Butler Yeats. Turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falconer. Things fall apart. The center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed. And everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. Surely some revelation is at hand. Surely the second coming is at hand. The second coming. Hardly are those words out when a vast image out of Spiritus Mundi troubles my sight. Somewhere in sands of the desert, a shape with lion body and the head of a man, a gaze blank and pitiless as the sun, is moving its slow thighs, while all about it reel shadows of the indignant desert birds. The darkness drops again. But now I know the 20 centuries of stony sleep were vexed to nightmare by a rocking cradle. And what rough beast, its hour come round at last, slouches towards Bethlehem to be born.
So those words are words that have been studied by a lot of people over the last 100 years. It's one of the best known William Yeats poems. And I want to tell you, we've chosen it because it captures the emotions of the New Testament when the New Testament talks about the second coming. But let me tell you what's really interesting around this. We often have sermon bumpers to introduce the teaching topic on Sunday morning. And I literally checked every site, that preachers and churches go to when they're going to speak. And I'm not exaggerating when I say there's literally hundreds of thousands of videos. I could not find that anybody had created a video on the second coming, except one cult did. And I like this video, so we used it. But I think it's interesting that we couldn't find anybody talking about that. Do you know, not many places are talking about the second coming. In fact, not many people are talking about several teachings in the Bible that if you go back through 20 centuries, everybody always talked about, including the second coming, and that Jesus will come back to judge the living and the dead. It's actually part of the earliest confession of faith, the Apostles' Creed, and it's been a part of the core teachings of the Bible going back to the beginning. And so interesting, you know, when you talk to people about these things, there's this big fear out there in churches now. We don't want to be associated with too much fire, hell, and brimstone. It's kind of like, ooh, those are bad. And so we want to be associated with feel good and be positive. And, you know, your best life today. Those are the things that we want to hear about. Now, we're all being discipled. We're all being discipled by somebody or some things. We're all being discipled by our culture pretty strong. Through social media, through education, through the movies we watch, the people we hang out with, we're all really being discipled by our culture. And in our culture, I guess, we're at a point where there are some teachings that just make us feel awkward and uncomfortable because we have no category for those teachings today. Does that make sense? I mean, when I started diving into this thing, I realized, wait, what's going on? And literally, I had to read, there's like 8 chapters in the New Testament. I can give these to you if you'd like. I literally had to go through all these 8 chapters on the second coming to make sure that the tone that we're going to take is the tone that is actually the tone of Scripture and of the New Testament. Now, let me give you just a little bit of background before we dive in and why this is so important. We are just finishing a series on the promised Messiah, and it's been really good. So we've talked about the Old Testament promises for the Messiah. Some of them go back to the book of Genesis. Many of them are in the book of Isaiah. Like last week, JP talked about the virgin birth. We've looked at Micah talking about the birth in Bethlehem. We've talked about that he would be a shepherd and how cool shepherds are, and God so loved the world that he sent his one and only son. And it's all really positive. It's all really cool. It all makes us feel good. This is an aside, unplanned moment here. But the thing that made me feel the best about Christmas Eve, I don't know if you know this, but when we had all the kids up here Christmas Eve, that was plan B. Because when we had our practice, plan A, it wasn't good. I was going to read the story, and the kids were bored, and everybody would have been bored. So we decided we were going to interview the children. And the great thing about the interview of the children is, man, they know that story better than a lot of adults. And it was really cool and really encouraging and really exciting. And I say all that to say this. As a church, the foundation of what Harpeth Community Church is built on is the teachings of the Bible, not the teachings of our culture. We want to be disciples of Jesus as he teaches us through his word, not disciples of the culture. And so what that means is this. We want to look at every part of the Bible, the whole counsel of God, the things that make us feel good and the things that make us, in the best sense, have fear. They're both a part of what the Bible teaches, and we want to be grounded in Scripture, just like those kids were Christmas Eve. So when we talk about the promised Messiah, this morning we're going to talk about the dominant understanding from the Old Testament, especially the dominant understanding that people had in the first century in the time of Jesus. And they did not focus their understanding on the birth of Jesus, that he would die for our sins, and he would be a great teacher, and that he would represent God's love and give us a chance to understand his teachings, and that he would die for our sins. They missed all of that in the first century because they were so focused on what we now know is the second coming. So I want to dive in. Now, I want to ask you to join with me this morning. There is an outline on the back of your bulletin as you came in, and you can follow along with that, or we're wanting everybody to get used to using our app. So if you will pull up the app on your phone, we actually have the sermon outline where you can fill in the blanks on your phone or iPad, if you have an iPad with us. Now, if you don't have the app, and by the way, if you go to sermons, that's where you'll find the sermon notes. Here's what you can do. Pull out your phone and put in the text part. Is everybody ready? 77977 HarpethCC app. So you're texting 77977 HarpethCC app. And then it'll send you back a link and you can get the church app. And you can get daily devotionals this week. We're going to provide you with the opportunity every week, Monday through Friday, brief devotionals that'll help you to get ready for the teaching. Then we're going to have the teaching, and then, of course, we have home groups that unpack the teaching. Because we just think that being in the Word of God is the real core foundation. It is the biggest predictor of your spiritual growth in 2020, getting into the Word of God. So we want to help you with all of that. Now, before I dive into these texts for us to look at, would you bow your heads with me? And I want to ask you to pray with me. Now, let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to go fast. I'm going to cover a lot of territory with you because it's important that we have an objective, factual basis. Here's what the Bible says. One of the things in our culture today is that people are being discipled to go by feelings. I feel, I like, I want. And there is a place for that. But a deeper place, a more important place for building a life is what's true, what's right, what does God say? Does that make sense? So we always want to be a church where we get into what the Bible says, we understand the Word of God, and then we apply it to, in a feeling way, how does this really work in our lives today? Make sense, everybody? So the first part, put on your thinking caps and join with me, and let's try to get into the content of God's Word, and then in the last part, we're going to apply it to where we live today. So if you would, please bow your heads with me. God, we come to you this morning, and I pray right now on behalf of Harpeth Christian Church for every eye that can see me and every ear that can hear me and what we're going to cover this morning, God, that you, your Holy Spirit, would bring these truths into our hearts and minds and lives, that we would honor you, and we would have the joy of living lives grounded in both grace and truth. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody who agreed with that prayer said? Amen. Amen. All right, let's look at the text together, and we're going to go back and to see how they understood it. So I'm going to go back to Daniel. Through Daniel, God promised to establish an everlasting kingdom. Now, this is the first time the whole concept of kingdom is crystal clear in the Bible. It's taken from Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. Now, I'm going to explain the context in just a second, but let me read it to you. In the time of those kings, and I know you don't know what those kings means at this point, but I will explain it. In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it will itself endure forever. So Daniel's writing. God's people are in captivity in Babylon, and he said, God's going to set up a kingdom that'll never be destroyed. Now, he's writing somewhere around 500 BC, 2,500 years ago, a long time ago, and in it, he has this vision. It's actually Nebuchadnezzar's vision of a statue that represents the kingdoms. You don't have to understand all this to get the point. The main point is God promised he was going to set up a kingdom, but he tells him 500 years in advance when it's going to be. So this statue is the vision from Nebuchadnezzar. The head represents the Babylonian Empire. Then the shoulders and arms represent the Medes and Persians. Then the waist represents the Greek Empire, Alexander the Great. And then the Roman Empire is both the shins and the feet. Probably some kind of sense of two phases of the Roman Empire. And here's what God told Daniel. During the days of those kings, God is going to set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. Now you say, kingdom, what's kingdom? A kingdom is simply where God's will is followed. Okay? Now, in the sense in which this means here, it's going to be a kingdom where God's will is followed in every square inch of the universe. And in every heart and in every place. Now, the kingdom can be, though, when God's will is followed by the power of the Holy Spirit in your heart and mind. And we'll come to that in just a second. So, secondly, through Daniel, God promised that the Son of Man's kingdom would never end. Again, let me read it to you. Daniel 7, verses 13 and 14. In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one, catch this, one like a son of man. This is going to be Jesus' most popular way of referring to himself in the Gospel of Mark, the son of man. It's only used to refer to the Messiah, as far as I can tell, here. So, there before me was one like a son of man. What's he doing? Coming in the clouds of heaven, he approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. Who's the Ancient of Days? The Ancient of Days here is going to be God the Father. So God the Father is going to be on the throne, and the Son of Man comes into his presence as Daniel's prophesying it, right? Now, we'll come back to the whole idea of in the heavens, in the clouds in just a second. But here's what Daniel says about that. He, this Messiah, was given, he's speaking about the future as though it was past tense. So he says, he was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and the peoples of every language worshiped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. In the Old Testament, the concept of a life after death is at best nebulous. It's there, but it's nebulous, and there's only a couple of places where, boom, it's really clear. This is one of those booms, it's really clear. If you'll go back, Lee, just 1 second so people can see that. So he's promising that his kingdom's going to be set up, and notice that the last part there. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. Wow, that's a big promise. So in the first century now, if we'll look at this picture of the Son of Man coming on the clouds, that was really dominant. If you're a Jewish person in the time of Jesus, that's how you think of the Messiah. You think he's going to come and set up a kingdom. He's going to approach the Father. He's going to have all authority, glory, and power, and all people and every language, they're going to worship him. Okay? In fact, look at the next line, the next point here. In the time of Jesus, everyone expected the Messiah to judge the world. Now, they did this based on the book of Daniel, but they also had other literature that I'm going to tell you about in just a second. I want you to know, in the first century, they didn't just have the Old Testament. They had, for example, Maccabees, which is a part of the Catholic Bible. They have Barak. There's this book I'm going to talk to you about called Enoch. It wasn't put in anybody's canon of scripture, but it was really well known. In fact, Enoch was so well known in the first century that as you think of people today who will go to Fox News or Fox News if you're on the right, CNN if you're on the left, and you want to find out what's going on, well, they'd look at Enoch and these other books to kind of help them to understand the Old Testament scriptures. Now, when the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered in 1948, they found, and the Dead Sea Scrolls are dated 300 years before Jesus. Some are up to, like the Isaiah Scrolls, 150 years before Jesus. They have all these prophecies about the Messiah, so it's really cool. But they found amongst the Dead Sea Scrolls Daniel, 167 BC, which is super interesting, and then the Book of Enoch. And this is just one part of the Book of Enoch. In the graduate work I did, we had to work our way through the Book of Enoch, so I've spent a fair bit of time on it. But just catch the sense of how when the Messiah comes, he's going to judge the world. So it says, and there was great joy amongst them, and they blessed and glorified and extolled because the name of that Son of Man had been revealed to them. They knew who the Messiah was, the Son of Man. They knew who he was. And he sat on the throne of his glory, and the sum of judgment was given unto the Son of Man. Why is he there? He's sitting on his throne, and he's given judgment. What does he do with that? And he caused the sinners to pass away and be destroyed from off the face of the earth, and those who had led the world astray. So what's the Son of Man going to do? He's going to judge. And when the Son of Man comes, when the Messiah comes, what do you want? If you're a good, righteous person, we want to be on his team, right? Okay? So, people believe the Messiah would fully establish the kingdom in their lifetime. So, in the first century, people just, they knew the Messiah's coming. It was common talk. And the question is, what's his name? Who is he? Now, the disciples, they've been with Jesus for a while. And in Matthew chapter 20, just to give us a real sense of how they thought, we see this scene where the mother of James and John comes to Jesus. Sometimes mothers can embarrass you. You know, shortly after I started ministry, I think I've told this story here before, but I was thinking about this when I was looking at what these guys are about to do. So we're in a smaller church, and back then you had congregational meetings to decide business affairs, and there was a guy. So my mother and father were a part of the church, and I was the senior pastor guy, and we have these meetings where, you know, anything's open for debate. And one of my friends got up, and he was saying I wasn't doing my job and all that. And it made my mom so mad. And so after the meeting's over, my mom, she made a beeline right to him. And he goes, "You're just saying that because he's your son." And my mother hauled off and whacked his hand out of the way. Now, wasn't it great that she loved me that much? Mothers always love your sons. Well, this is a moment like that for James and John. It says, "Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons and kneeling down asked a favor of him." "What is it you want?" Jesus asked. Good thing, okay. She said, "Well, grant that one of these two sons of mine may sit at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom." Hey, you're the Messiah. Pretty soon you're going to inaugurate everything and destroy all the enemies, and it's going to be the ways of the Messiah. Hey, my sons who are hanging out with you and giving you their time, they've abandoned their business. They're just being, you know, irresponsible, but they're following you. So when you come in your kingdom, will you appoint them one on your right and one on your left? Jesus says, "You don't know what you're asking about." You see, they thought the Messiah was going to come, and to be in his kingdom on earth was the best thing you could do. And that, if all you had was Daniel and Enoch, you don't have that he's got to be our example, he's got to be our teacher, and that according to Isaiah 53, that he's going to die on the cross for our sins. They missed all that in the first century. It was there, but they didn't see it. By the way, I wanted to show you a picture because people still think this way today. Jewish people still think this way. I was there a couple years ago on, I forget what day it was, but the main newspaper had "Messiah Come," you know, on it. And these are ultra-Orthodox. This was taken about 10 years ago. You notice to the far right, it's Mike Wineland. I think Mike's over here this morning, and some of the guys there. And we're standing there for this picture. In the back is the remnants of the temple from the first century. There's the Western Wall or the Wailing Wall behind them. But I wanted you to know something that you wouldn't know without somebody telling you, because I didn't know. But do you notice how they're dressed? Now, for you to appreciate how they're dressed, you got to think of the styles in the early 1900s. These guys are dressed in their best because they're waiting for the Messiah to come and establish the kingdom, just like they did in the first century. You'll see some ultra-Orthodox with hats that are worth like $3,000, and these white shirts that they have. I mean, they are dressed in their best because the Messiah may come at any moment. And that's how they live their entire lives today, waiting for the Messiah. So what does that tell us? It tells us that embedded in the Old Testament, if all you had was the Old Testament, is this dominant idea that when the Messiah comes, he's coming to judge. But it also reminds us of what we focus on almost exclusively, and that's the good part, that he came to die for our sins and make us forgiven by God, and that we're living with him now in anticipation that he's going to come back, and before he comes back, that God wants that word of Jesus the Messiah to go to every nation. In fact, in Matthew 14, it says that's one of the preconditions before he comes back, that the word goes out everywhere. So look at the next diagram. Jesus taught that the kingdom would come in two phases. And it's important that we say this because it hasn't been said enough throughout history. There's the first coming where he inaugurates the kingdom. It's the already but not yet kingdom. And then there's the second coming, which is the consummated kingdom, when Jesus returns and we're the earth is transformed as God intends it. Okay? Now, can everybody see that diagram? It's on your outline, and I think it's on the app as well. I want you to look at it really carefully, because it's super important that you know this. Now, remember when I gave you that definition of the kingdom? Let me tell you two again. The kingdom is where the will of God has its way. What God wants is what happens. Okay? So when we look at the world today and we say, like, one of the things we should be saying, to use New Testament language, is, I'm in the kingdom. That, God's kingdom is at work in my life. Well, what that means is the will of God, God's will is having its way with me through the Holy Spirit. The primary way that the kingdom of God is manifest today is when the Holy Spirit has sway over our hearts and minds, and we surrender and we do what God wants us to do. In the book of Romans, it says the kingdom of God is of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And that comes when God has his way. Okay, so when you look at the diagram then, you can see that the present age, we're still living in a sense of exile. We're not at home with in the Garden of Eden. There's oppression, there's sin and death all around us. Last Sunday afternoon, Matt and Brandy Nielsen asked me to go and be with Matt's father, who's on his deathbed. He's dying. By the way, great opportunity. I shared with him the story of the thief on the cross on his deathbed. And he said, I want that. So it was really just an awesome, awesome thing. But it is a part of our life here. So when Jesus came, his first coming, his life, his teaching, his death, resurrection, and ascension, the kingdom of God began. The reign of God began. That's why the New Testament, Jesus says, the kingdom of God is with you, the kingdom of God is amongst you. Because through Jesus, it's an already, but not yet kingdom. Waiting his return, where the fully realized kingdom will come about with the resurrection of the dead. And then notice, when it's fully consummated, the restoration of the kingdom, the new heaven, the new earth, freedom from oppression, sin, death, Satan, that's all gone. And the Messiah will reign over all of Israel. And as JP pointed out, we're going to have communion with him again in the new heaven and new earth. Now, real quick, some passages about this. Let's look together at them, okay? I want you to ask this question, by the way. Again, just let me state reality. We are all being discipled by somebody or some things. Let's be discipled by the Word of God and the Spirit of God, so that these ways are ways we think. So, Luke 17, once on being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, Jesus replied, the coming of the kingdom of God is not something that you can observe, nor will people say, here it is or there it is, because the kingdom of God is in your midst or within you. Here Jesus is referring to that first sense of the inaugurated kingdom. It's the range of God's effective will. So wherever things are the way that God wants them to be, that's where his kingdom reign is manifest. Now, when you think about that, think about your will and your kingdom, and God's will, and his kingdom. So each one of us have a kingdom. I got a kingdom, you got a kingdom, Damien's got a kingdom, Chris has got a kingdom. Chris Wilson, who's visiting us from Idaho this morning, he has a kingdom. And a kingdom, our kingdoms are where our will is what happens. What we want and what we implement, it happens, right? Like every two-year-old realizes that they have a kingdom. What are their two most popular words? The first one is no, and the second one is mine, because they're learning to have a kingdom. So when God's kingdom is at work in your life and in my life, it's what God wants is what's happening. It's whenever things are going the way God would want them to go. But we can just look out in my life and yours and in the world and we say, well, the kingdom's not yet been fully established, right? I mean, the reality that you live with every day and that I live with every day is that, my goodness, I wish my kingdom were smaller and God's was bigger in my life. And my goal, and the Beatitudes and the Sermon on the Mount are so helpful in this, is to be poor in spirit, to hunger and thirst for righteousness, because all of those things are what happens when the kingdom is at work in our lives. Now, let's talk about that second part of the kingdom. And this is the part where I just want to ask you to join with me. This is not comfortable. Like, what we want, we like good news. We want things to be bright and shiny. People come to church because they want to be inspired and, you know, joyful and happy and all those things. In fact, whole churches are built around, you know, we're a consumer culture. You want to give the customer what the customer wants. The customer wants to be happy and encouraged and think everything is good. And so it's really easy in church that you're going to build a church that way. But that's not how you follow the Bible. The way to build a church according to the Bible is the teachings of God. And some of the teachings of God are hard to hear, but they're really good for us because they help us to build lives based on God's reality and of the realization of everything we're going to face. Okay? So Jesus is with his disciples. This is described in Matthew 24. He's with his disciples, and they're all caught up in this kingdom. They know Enoch, they know Daniel, they all caught up in the kingdom. And it says that Jesus left the temple, and he was walking away from the temple. And his disciples came to him, and they called his attention to the stones. Josephus tells us that the stones were so bright that you could see them. The sun would bounce off them, and you could see the temple miles away. Jesus then uses that to say something to the disciples. He said, "Do you see all these things? I tell you, not one stone will be left on another. Everyone will be thrown down." Well, the disciples are thinking, "Okay, good. This is you've helped us, Jesus. When are you going to establish that kingdom? We've been waiting for you to cut through the chase and tell us what's really going on, you son of man." As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. "Okay, Jesus, tell us." Now they ask three questions. Notice there's three questions here. You cannot understand Matthew 24, which I know is not our main point, but you wouldn't understand it unless you look for all three questions. When will this happen, the temple be destroyed? What will be the sign of your coming? Oh, you're coming. And what will be the sign of the end of the age? Good questions, right? So let me just show you the temple real quick. In Jerusalem in 30 AD, this is how Jerusalem looked. Notice how dominant the temple is. And many people described it as one of the wonders of the ancient world. And when you go there, you can still see the remnant of the temple. It blows your mind. Okay, huge thing. This next is archaeologists had a reconstruction of it. And you can see what it would have been like. It's massive, like any Cool Springs Mall or anything like that. The stones were brighter and more magnificent than you can see them here. Now look at this next picture. In the late 90s, archaeologists dug back the rubble. That's Mike Eagle, who's a part of the church here, in the rubble where every throne was stoned down. Every stone was thrown down by the Romans. It was destroyed. Now, here's why it's important. If you read through the Bible, you're going to read and look at the second coming. You're going to read Mark 13, Matthew 24, Luke 21. You're going to read 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. I'm sorry, 2nd Thessalonians chapter 1, 2nd Thessalonians chapter 2. And you're going to read Revelation 18, 19, and 20. Those are the dominant verses in the Bible, the eight chapters. And here's what you're going to find. All of them teach one way or another. Things are going to get bad before the second coming. Most people will be caught off guard. And when the second coming happens, they're not happy. But literally, it says, they will mourn. Now, why are they mourning? Because they're not ready. Now, I want you to hear me on this one thing. The Bible teaches, and I've learned by experience that it's true what I'm about to tell you. The Bible teaches this in Romans chapter 1. Everybody knows there is a God. You sit here to me this morning, you say, I'm an atheist, and say, okay, you think you're an atheist. Because I actually did graduate work with atheists. I know the best atheists you can imagine. And here's what even atheists will admit when nobody's looking and they've had a few drinks of wine. Sometimes I think that there's really a God out there, but don't tell anybody. And here's what it is. The book of Romans says we suppress the knowledge of God. Our culture suppresses the knowledge of God. If you're being discipled by the culture, just know our culture is suppressing the knowledge of God. Now, are there problems that atheists bring up that are legitimate problems we've got to work through? Yes. In our series, for example, in February, we're going to be in the book of Genesis, looking at creation, evolution, homosexuality, all those things. We're gonna dive into that in our series on the book of Genesis. But I want you to know this. Everybody knows there is a God. So when Jesus Christ returns, that's why they will mourn. It's this thing that you've had a gnawing awareness of that you ignored all your life. You're going to have to face it. Now, just before the end, the picture is things get bad. Now, so let's just look at Matthew 24. Again, I got to be conscious of our time. And Jeff and Lee at the back, I don't know where we're at time-wise this morning because the clock, either I've gone past 35 minutes or... the clock's not working, so flash something up there for me. Okay. Well, I got to worry about it because the people watching the kids will always get on to me when we go late. So, I mean, I'd teach you all day. We'd be here at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You'd be going, Bobby, when are you going to be done? All right. But here's what Jesus is teaching them about the second coming. If those days had not been cut short, what? The time just before the end. It's going to be bad. If those days had not been cut short, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, for the sake of biblical disciples, those days will be shortened. Now, at that time, when it's going to happen, if anyone says to you, look, here's the Messiah, or there he is, don't believe it. What? Jesus is literally saying toward the end, there's going to be people who say, hey, Chris, I got the secret. I got the secret insight here. I know where the Messiah is, or come out to the desert with me, or Read this book. It's called Awake, and it predicts when he's going to come back. And all these people in Australia thought, he says it won't be anything like that. He goes on and says, for false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and wonders to deceive, if it is possible, even the elect. See, Jesus says, I've told you ahead of time. And then he says this. So if anyone tells you, there he is out in the wilderness, don't go out. Or here he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. By the way, I quoted for you a couple of groups. I'm trying to be careful because I don't want to just say bad things about them, but actually what a couple of groups have already said about Jesus already came back secretly. So it's already begun. He says, don't believe it. Now he's going to give you an analogy here, and he gives another one that I don't have the scripture up. Here's the first analogy. Does anybody know what it looks like when there's lightning in the sky? Who can see the lightning? Everybody in the area can see the lightning in the sky. So he says, for as lightning that comes from the east is visible even in the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. In other places, he'll say, you know, when there's a vulture that... below the vultures in the sky, especially in the desert, there's a carcass down below. So it's going to be clear to everyone. And then he says this in verse 30. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Again, it's this idea, this vision from the book of Daniel, chapters 2 and chapter 7. Notice that picture? He's literally drawing on that picture, which is not a, it's a visual, a mental picture. And then he will send the angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the others. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day, what day your Lord will come. So you must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. And then lastly, this, I just want to share this last verse with you from Revelation. It literally describes it this way. Look, he's coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him. Who will see him? Every eye. Even those who pierced him, which is a direct quote, by the way, right from the book of Zechariah. It's talking about Jewish people. Jewish people are going to see him. And all peoples of the earth, now this is, to me, this is like really sad, but it's true. All the peoples on the earth will mourn because of him. So shall it be. Amen. So let me talk to you about this. And just let's take a few minutes here and apply it to our lives. The Bible teaches that Jesus did come. The Bible promised, the Old Testament promised, the Messiah would come. And he's going to do great, wonderful things for those who have faith. For those who surrender and say, I surrender to you, Jesus. We cannot imagine the wonderful things God has prepared for us. But now that the gospel is going out to the whole world, and when the gospel has gone out to the whole world, the Bible says he will come back. We don't know exactly when, and most people will not be ready. And my question is, do you think that way? Like, do we think that way? Jesus gave us a daily prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. At the end of 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul prays, Lord Jesus, come. Are we praying that he's going to come back? Or are we thinking, well, I don't want him to come back yet because I got this other thing on earth and this joyful thing here on earth and I want that. Ultimately, when Jesus comes back, it's the fulfillment of our lives, because the greatest thing in our lives is our relationship with God and God's relationship with us. And to not have this veil and these shadows, but to have God with us. Now, some reflections that I wish we had more time on, and we'll have more time later. The first thing I just want to say that this makes me aware of in ways I can't describe really well, but it makes me aware of the holiness of God. You say, the holiness of God, what's that? Is that God determines how life really should be. God made us, God made the world, and God tells us that we must understand his holiness to understand him. Here's the thing that we're tempted to do in our culture as our culture is discipling us. We are tempted to think it's all about the love of God. So I have a question for you. Which is more important in the Bible, the love of God or the holiness of God? They're both. They are both equally important, but we are so enamored with the love of God that the love of God becomes this permissive, accept everything, accept everybody, don't worry about anything anywhere because God's going to somehow take care of it. And that is not what the Bible teaches. It's the love of God and the holiness of God. Look at our values. We want to grow in grace and truth. It's grace and truth, the goodness and severity of God who does send people to hell. It's righteousness and mercy. Those are all part of the package. So my question for all of us is, are we emphasizing both? Are we holding in our minds both? Because Jesus is coming back. And when he comes back, it is so important that we build our lives around both of those things. The second thing is, because we don't have a high view of God's holiness, we are losing the concept of the fear of God. Now, just bear with me on this. When God first wanted Moses to understand who he was, what did God do? Well, he calls Moses out of a burning bush, and what does God say to Moses? Like, God is in the bush. God says to Moses, take off your shoes, you're standing on. He wanted Moses to have a sense of the fear of God. Proverbs the complete book of Proverbs, but it nails it in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, as it's setting it up. It says, the fear of God is the It's the beginning of wisdom. We pray a daily prayer. What is the daily prayer? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Holy would be your name. Harpeth Christian Church, it is so important that you and I and that all of us, we are a community grounded in both the love of God and the holiness of God, a sense of the goodness of God and a fear of God. Because if we don't have a fear of God, we're going to make up the rules as we see fit. Rather than letting God transform us to be people who honor him. So today, I have a great privilege with the guys who are in my transformation group. We are actually working through some material, and I mention this material because if we could, we'd love for all of you to go through this material. If you're not in a transformation group, this is an explicit, overt invitation. Mark it on the card and we'll get you in one. But when we wanted to summarize kind of the core teachings of the Bible, we realized we need both the holiness of God and the love of God. In fact, we cannot understand Jesus dying on the cross apart from the holiness of God. You see, the biggest barrier between us and God is that he is holy and every one of us commits sin. And God, who is holy, cannot be in the presence of sinful people. But God found a way by sending his son to die on the cross and to take away our sin so that we could be reconciled to God. And so today with my guys, we're actually just hanging out today, my guys and their wives and children, just to cultivate our relationship. But when we come back together, we're going to talk about the holiness of God. And I wanted to give you a verse that really drives me, and I hope it would drive you in terms of being disciples who make disciples. Look at this from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. The Apostle Paul is summing up his ministry and why he does what he does. And then he has these words, thinking about the second coming. Like, before I read it, let me just back up and ask you a question. When you think about the second coming, are you thinking, I want to be ready. I don't want to be sinning. That would be a good thought. Like, don't live active, deliberate, sinful lifestyles. When you think about the second coming, I want to help everybody to hear about it. Those are good thoughts. You want to think about, I've stored up a lot of treasures in heaven. Like when you think of the sacrifice of tithing and giving and offerings and serving, you want to send a lot of things ahead of you. Because when Jesus comes back, everything's going to be destroyed except for what you sent ahead. But are you thinking about the people you want there with you? This is Paul's vision. He says, what is our hope? What do I hope about? What like pumps me up? What is our hope, our joy, or the crown? And they use the language of crowns because crowns are what you get when you're the victor. He says, what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus when he comes? And then he says this, writing to this church, he says, is it not you? You, the people. Indeed, you are our glory and joy. So here's what he's saying. On that day when Jesus comes back, do you know what Paul's joy, and I just want you to know this is where I'm at now. This matters more to me than anything else, and I hope it can matter more to all of us. It's going to be that we're there with people we really care about. The people we really love, they're there, and they're ready for when Jesus returns so we can all be together forever and ever in the new heaven and new earth. There is no better vision. There's no better joy than to know that our loved ones, our friends, our relatives, our neighbors, or the people that God has just put into our lives. So in our group, my guys, my goal as a pastor with everyone, I just want us all to be ready. Like you, the people of Harpeth Christian Church, when the leaders of this church think about, you're our hope and our glory and our joy on that day that Jesus would have discipled us, not the culture in which we live. Make sense? Well, I had a couple more things to say, but I've obviously not planned very well today with my time. I do want to tell you just a little bit how this teaching sets up what we want to talk to you about starting next Sunday. So the title of the series is called Transforming Your Life, and it's habits that will help us as we head into 2020 to really live out the grace and truth of Jesus, to really surrender to Christ as Lord, to really love like Jesus and be the kind of people. In fact, the real goal when we talk about transforming your life, you know what your life looks like when it's really transformed? We love God and love people like Jesus did. That's a transformed life, to love God and love people the way Jesus did. So we're going to talk about some habits. By the way, tomorrow morning, if you listen to Moody Radio, I'm going to be on Moody Radio from 6 to 9 talking about habits for 2020, which the big habit I'm pushing on the radio show is getting in the Word of God on a daily basis. But for Harpeth Christian Church, here's what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about the importance of Sunday morning church. Now, let me talk to you to tell you I'm really struggling with what to say, and here's why. The Bible's really clear that Sunday morning church would be a priority if you're a disciple of Jesus, but more and more people are coming up with all these excuses not to go to church. And nationally, there's this huge church drop-off. It's even in our midst. And here's the thing. Maybe some of you can help me. I don't know how to break through that new mindset other than to let's look at the Word of God so that we make it a high priority. And we want to talk about growing in groups and with the Word of God. We want to talk about giving our time, talents, and treasures. And we want to talk about go and making disciples of others. So I asked the band to come up because we, just as a church, one of the things we think is really important is that if something is on our hearts when we come in here, or maybe it's on our hearts from what's been said, or on our hearts from the Word of God, and we need to make a commitment to God, then we just want to be a church where we're doing that every Sunday. We're just coming to the altar. We're coming to the Lord. And so I want to give you that opportunity. I also want to give this opportunity, because I know there's people here now, and you've actually never surrendered your life to Jesus, but you have expressed that you want to, just something's holding you back. So here's what I want to do. I want to ask if you're ready this morning to commit your life to Jesus, we're going to go over to the cross. My wife and I are going to ask Michelle Eagle to meet me over there. And if you're ready today, there's no better day than today for you to make that decision. It's never too late, and it's never too early to commit your life to Christ. So let me give you an opportunity for most of us to come to the altar, and Cindy and I will be at the cross. God bless you.